the setting for our Christmas season. It's amazing the parallels we're facing with that very first Christmas. Living under the uncertainty of a paranoid leader, unwilling to leave his throne, an economically fragile time where the poor are getting poorer and the wealthy are making huge gains, a time when upheaval and violence and revolution is in the air, acts of protest, bombs going off. We can identify, can't we, with Mary's churning stomach, with unsettled hearts and minds and deep hopes for change and deep fears of what that change might cost. Mary's time with Elizabeth may have involved its share of difficulty, but it also does provide a kind of creative space, pregnant with future, with a new coming, with a new world ready to be born. Mary and Elizabeth, these two cousins, seem to be good for each other, creating significant spiritual and intellectual and imaginative shelter in a time when they both need it. Luke, true to form, would want us to see it this way, I think. 3 months in his writing is often the time that it takes to nurture some new beginning in the midst of extreme upheaval. In the book of Acts, Luke tells us that Paul stayed at Ephesus for 3 months and formed a church during that time. And then he stayed in Greece for 3 months to rest after these violent schemes threatened his life. And from that visit, he emerged with renewed energy and force. Later, as he travels to Rome for trial, upon which he could lose his life, his ship is destroyed in a storm and he's rescued. And he stays at the island of Malta for 3 months ahead of his trial. And so it makes sense that Luke would tell us about this very young and anxious Mary seeking the presence and shelter of her older cousin Elizabeth for 3 months. And it makes sense that Elizabeth is glad to provide that sanctuary for Mary and gains from it herself. After all, Mary is too young to be pregnant. Elizabeth is way too old, but circumstances and calling have brought them together in a strange partnership. We tend to associate youth with strength and future, passion, and old age with a kind of barrenness and inevitability. But this story sees things different because Mary and Elizabeth end up carrying this future together. Luke even makes reference to another strange pregnancy in telling their story. He refers to Sarah, another time when God did something revolutionary and new. He writes, referring to these pregnancies as happening, quote, according to the promise God made to our ancestors, to Abraham and Sarah and their descendants forever. It seems that in God's way of working, one generation needs the other. Elizabeth, as an old woman, is generating new life, and she feels that what she's doing is intimately connected to the new hope that Mary embodies. As Elizabeth puts it, as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, Mary, the child in my womb leaped for joy, and blessed is she who believed that there would be fulfillment of what was spoken to her. Her child, destined to grow up to be John the Baptist, paves the way for Mary's child, Jesus. And so the two of them, young and old, are in intimate partnership together with visions and callings that will go generations beyond either of them. Here at First Congregational, we are in a Christmas season under the weight of a pandemic, but also under the joy of new dreaming. The Walker Center will come to birth in the year ahead. Our building will offer new accessibility and new beauty, enable new programs and welcome new people. We have new ministries in the arts to explore, new ventures in pastoral care and congregational development as we move forward. We have new partnerships that are evolving. We've been working to deliberately use this time to prepare for a new season. And so from the experience of spiritual and psychological malabariga imposed by COVID-19, we've been trying to discern the new beginnings that are wanting to take place. We have new vision and energy from the partnership of an incredible staff and dedicated and wise congregational leadership. And here's the takeaway for me personally, and maybe for our entire congregation, from this partnership of Elizabeth and Mary. Both Elizabeth and Mary have responsibility for bringing this new future that God wants to bear. But the older woman, Elizabeth, privileges Mary in some ways, privileges Mary, this younger woman, in her pregnancy. Elizabeth prioritizes Mary's need for hospitality and sanctuary over her own needs, which might have been substantial as an older woman in her 6 month of pregnancy. Elizabeth shows a willingness to listen to Mary's voice and vision and prioritize it over her own. She utters a word of affirmation and blessing of her own, to be sure, but she steps aside and makes room so that this new voice of Mary might ring out. Is that a model for us at any levels? It seems to me that in these past months of social and political malabarigo through the country, of this evil belly we've felt, we've seen young voices start insisting on kinds of social change, rightly refusing to be put off as they call for us, all of us, to look at systemic racism and the need for economic equity and the care of the environment. At a more personal level, I see it as a call to take more and more seriously the needs of our children and our isolated seniors who have suffered and struggled with COVID this year, and the challenges that they face in a disrupted world with a disrupted future. And to take seriously our need to show patience and presence, to create safe space, maybe for our own family members who need sanctuary as they deal with their own struggles and anxieties and the malabariga that lives within all of us. It may be time for the more established among us, the more mature, to focus less on maintaining our place so that we can prioritize and assist with the challenges faced by the less experienced, the less mature, the less resourced, and show graciousness and care. You know, in later writings, Luke will talk about old men dreaming dreams and young ones having new visions. In a season where we are struggling with so much that we can't control, where we have these painful minutes and feelings of separation and grief, Elizabeth's witness reminds us that there is a wisdom that comes through the years in knowing that God's hand is on the world and can offer blessing if we trust and open ourselves to it. But we have to make room for it, welcome it, prioritize it. What is new can feel intimidating, and the choices and circumstances of others can seem bewildering to us. We can only control what we can control, and we try to live in the grace of God to take care of the rest. As a church congregation in the new year, we're going to be wrangling with a building being renewed ultimately, but not before there's a lot of upheaval, literally from construction. It will feel disruptive at first. We will also be celebrating and growing from the voices of our staff members, a new focus on the voices of our own church children, and intentionality about inviting new people to find their way into this community. There are learning curves that we will have to encounter together. None of us have all the answers, clearly. But I hear in this story of Mary and Elizabeth deep encouragement to let new vision lead, to bring young voices, young leaders to the center of the dialogue, and to not leave them at the sidelines waiting their turn. Our best remedy to spiritual malabariga is to trust and to listen. God gives us what we need when we need it. And it's beautiful to celebrate this fire of Mary, her vision, her strength, her calling, her passion. And it's also beautiful to see the wisdom of Elizabeth, her grace and her trust developed through years of living in a tumultuous world. She was wise about knowing what to hold on to and what to let go of, where to maintain and where to give up. This Christmas story is carved out of strange partnerships. Scholars from the East, angels, shepherds, dreamers, politicians, bureaucrats and rebels, teenagers and old folks, saints and sinners. And they all come together, struggling with Malabariga some days, hoping for the new tomorrow they believed would come. This Christmas reminds us with particular focus that God needs all of us working together, just as God has always needed all of the human family working together to bring the new future of which we dream. Amen. We now worship God as we present our offerings.
Good morning and Merry Christmas. It is the third day of Christmas. So I see three of my hens out there, my three singing hens. And it is the second day of Kwanzaa. And as I listened to Pastor Cheryl's message this morning, I thought it is amazing. We don't have committee meetings on what we're going to emphasize. The Spirit just brings us to the same points. You know, truth is just truth. And so as we look at this, the last Sunday in December, the last Sunday in 2020, we have a lot of transitions taking place all over the world. They're both spiritual and physical and political and economic. And some of them are good and some of them are not so good. But we're going to walk through a few of ours. As a matter of fact, you will actually see a lot of them in media this Sunday, people looking at who passed and who did what. And Tony Coleman is not with us this morning because he is completing his ministry at All Souls Unitarian Church, from which he came to back home this Sunday. And they want to paw and maul over him like we were doing Janice and Brian. And he notified us this morning, and we wish him the best. I have to tell you that All Souls is where I was married many, many years ago. And Marcus was baptized in that garden. So I bless him, and we send him safe virtual travel to that journey, and know that they are sending him back home with blessings. And then we have this as Dennis's last Sunday. And you know, we blessed him some weeks ago, anointed him actually, and we've thanked him and we've wept for him and we've wept over him and we've hired another person who is going to be his successor. Notice I didn't say to fill his shoes, but his successor. And Dennis, we're just taking one more opportunity to give you our blessings for you to go forth in whatever God has for you in your new venue and in your new work in Columbus, Ohio. Be careful, Dennis. It's not so safe there right now. And then soon you will be gifted. Soon and very soon, you will be gifted by us, but that's not today. We do want to revisit the video that Julia put together for you and just remember again with you, this is what makes us community. All these little threads going back and forth and back and forth. So let's take a look at that video one more time, Dennis, as we say, mwah.
Here in my eyes, so
Pictures tell you an awful lot about feelings. Words do a little bit. So let's join together in our affirmation of community and try to capture some of what we're feeling, not only for Dennis, but for each other. We will be together. We will stand as brothers and sisters, given life by one God. We will be together. We will watch out for one another. We will listen to what needs to be said in a spirit of compassion. We will respect the power of silence. We will wait for the slowest. We will sooner or later catch up with the fastest. We will dry the tears of those who are weeping and know that they will dry ours when the time comes. We will let ourselves begin to feel at least a little of the pain of those we have considered our enemies. We will entrust our stories to each other. We will not be skeptical that peace can come. We will not forget the joy of life. We will not forget to be grateful. We will do our best to stir in each other hope, courage, and faith. Will you pray with me this morning? God of orderly transitions, no matter how many devices we invent or purchase, we cannot control or predict the mysteries of your timing. There was Elizabeth, longing to bear a child for so many years, according to the reproductive clock of her day. And yet, she was right on time to be an emotional landing pad, a doula, a coach for young cousin Mary, regarded as prematurely pregnant, since it was before her marriage. As the wife of a priest, Elizabeth had probably had many women, helped many women through pregnancy and childbirth experiences. Not only is Elizabeth two-thirds of the way through pregnancy for her long-awaited child, Mary arrived as she was beginning her morning sickness. And well, there's more to even that. Elizabeth is carrying the chosen child to create a spiritual path for the arrival of Mary's son, Jesus, Son of God, your chosen seed and son. What we see with human eyes are often illusions of truth in the middle of divine mysteries that you, God, are creating. There is much we really do not know about what we know. God, our guide, there are some of the things that we do know, and these are they. We really are leaning and depending on you to oversee this nation through an orderly transfer of power in January. We need your intervention for the pending COVID-19 stimulus package to avoid so much more human suffering and so many more tragedies. We need your peaceful order in the Georgia U.S. Senate runoff elections. We need your order in state houses, legislative halls, courtrooms, public gatherings of every kind. We need your order to patrol our streets day and night in the north and in the south, urban and suburban. We need the real you by any name you are called in houses of worship where love reigns. We need peaceful order in places where we inhabit and in the hearts that inhabit our bodies. We ask these things in your name, amen. And amen. God, we join Lindley Schmidt, challenged with her own health problems and issues, who comes not asking for prayer for herself today, but for another part of her family. Matt Groves, age 30, died suddenly on December 18th. Matt was married to Lindley's niece, Kayla Groves, who is 3 months pregnant with their first child. Mother, Father, God, We join Lindley in prayer throughout this pregnancy for a good birthing and your guiding light on the journey of this widowed woman and fatherless child. We lift up families of any composition everywhere as this challenging year ends. In the season of giving at First Congo, we committed to one another on Pledge Sunday in our breakout rooms to pray for the families in that room all year round. And we revisit that commitment with this dedication again today. We still have an unknown distance to travel with COVID-19 haunting our wellness, our economic stability, relationships, mental health, and preferred communal lifestyles. We give thanks for everyone packing, transporting, vaccinating, and making vaccine discoveries. We lift the name and the work of NIH lead researcher, Kizzy Corbett, Dr. Kizzy Corbett, an African-American woman in her 30s, whom Dr. Fauci is giving credit for taking the lead and bringing the vaccine to us. We lift the blessed memories of those once among us gone because of COVID-19. We remember Betsy Reeder. Now in our personal silence, we remember with gratitude prayers. Heavenly parents, we lift our hearts and release our named and unnamed burdens in your holy name. Amen, amen, and amen.
Thy name, thy kingdom come.
us continue in prayer as we recite the covenant prayer. We covenant with the Lord and one with another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. Now, I just want to prepare you for one more transition, but it's short term. I have been working for a year and a half, we figured out, through the transition without a break. And so I'm going to be with you in spirit and on screen, but not at this pulpit for the month of January. So I ask that you pray for me to be restored in energy and spirit and to do the work that God has for me, whatever that turns out to be. I will be attending some meetings and keeping up with the Walker Center work, but I just won't be here. But I will continue to pray for you. And as I said, pray for me as best you can. I appreciate that more than you can ever imagine. So while I'm not here, I'm not really saying gone. I want you to pray for peace for our nation. Got that? Pray with your eyes open. Got that? Stay woke.
The blessing of God Almighty, Jesus our brother, and the Holy Spirit our strength, be with us and abide with us always. Amen. And now we'll join in singing My Soul Cries Out.
Hey.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hi, everybody.
Wow.
Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Happy third day of Christmas.
To the screen. Good to see you all.
Yeah.
Hey,
oh, you're too far away.
Too far away.
Oh, you
could expect to see you on screen, though, even so.
Yes.
Oh,
we love you.
We love you. Love you.
So glad.
Thank you. That video was very emotional.
Yes. It's
a Lordy, all those pictures.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Callum is not there.
He's blocked himself.
Hey, folks. Good job, Ron.
Look at those masks.
Good job. Your masks are all very
you say it all.
I love it. I love it. What? Hey, oh, hey, you guys. Say hello. This is Cheryl's niece.
Hey, Emily.
Hey.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
Good to see you guys.
Still going strong.
Yeah.
They're all working hard. We're getting a lot of honey from them.
Tell your family hello.
I will. I will. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, let's go see Miss Phoenix.
Hey. Yeah.
Hi. Hey,
sweetie pie.
Yeah.
Big.
That was beautiful.
Beautiful.
Oh, there, Phoenix.
Is
that a wand?
I like
the Elsa and Anna and.
That was crazy.
All
priorities right there.
All right,
yeah.
Merry Christmas, everybody. A happy
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
Don't bring me cabbage lighting up.
Yeah. Oh, let's see it light up. Hang on.
That's very nice.
Oh, she's a mermaid. Oh.
Mermaid, yeah.
That's pretty cool. Oh, and you better.
What kind of toy do I have do you like?
Oh, one likes that. One doesn't.
Yeah.
Well, Santa Claus gave me this, and Santa Claus gave me this too.
Yeah. There
you go.
Wow.
Actually, seems to.
Yes.
Let's say a good morning.
Hi, David.
Hey, Dave and Judy.
Hey.
Oh, as always.
Good morning.
Like a living dog.
Yeah.
Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Merry
Christmas.
Bye, everybody. We got to go eat. It's an hour later here.
Oh. Thank you, Dennis.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Brian.
Bye. See you next Sunday.
Thank you. Love you. Yeah, see you next Sunday.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh, I was going to come say, how's old Santa Fe holding up?
Hey, everybody. Marcia, I'm so excited about the adult forum.
Yes, we got a great launch today. Oh, it was fabulous.
Oh, yeah?
Thank you.
We're going to have fun. Come and join us, everybody.
Yeah, you should bring George along, too. I don't know where he is.
He's going to sing next week.
Uh-huh. All right, George. Wait for
everybody
it.
Show up.
Great.
Merry Christmas.
Here's Miss Margaret. Let's say a quick hello. Hi, Margaret.
Hey, Margaret.
Hello, everybody. Merry Happy Christmas. Thursday of Christmas. Yeah. It's really good to see you all and to listen to the chatter. So,
that's right.
Look forward to seeing you all in the new year.
Yeah.
You look great, Margaret.
Oh, I am so blessed. I just am. I wore my Christmas sweater.
Good to see everybody. Hey,
yes, it is.
Hey, Katie. Hey, Kevin.
Hey.
All right, guys. I'm going to wave us off.
Merry Christmas. Bye-bye.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Love everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thursday night. See you Thursday.
Thursday night.
Come go to the house.
Bye-bye.
Bye.